Thank you. So I will try to show you what we have done in France to foster the research on red cells. And at the end, I will make some practical proposition to try to set up some collaborative work between France and Brazil. So a few years ago in France, the national government put some money, they call for the investment for the future program, and to try to set up some and group some people who are doing good science and with a they call laboratory of excellence, and to try to foster the basic research, but to translate this basic research to clinical application and to some patent and creation of biotechnology in order to get back some money from what they have invested in the past. So what we decided to do, I'm sorry, in France was to try to put together people working on red cells, because we realized that amongst hematologists and PhD and even scientists, the red cells field was going down, because most of the young investigators prefer to go to malignant disease and study leukemia and cancer, immunology and genetics, but not too much red cells. And for a lot of people, red cells was seeing as the past of the history. I'm sorry. So we were able to group 18 laboratories in France working on red cells, and we present a dossier, and we get, like, you know, the first place, Execo, and the government gave us like 8 million euros for 10 years. So with this money, we can do everything we want, almost, and try to set up something around the red cell. So what we decided to do is to get a very good basic and improve and foster the basic research on red cells, including erythropoiesis and iron metabolisms and sickle cell disease and malaria and blood transfusion, and try to translate this basic research to translational research with patients, and try also to do some technology transfer in order to have some new development for diagnosis and treatment. And obviously we have to do some education around red cells to show that it is a good thing to do for students. So here are the general indicators that we have to follow if we want to succeed, and actually we decided to do these general indicators, and actually the people accept them. So I will present what we decided to do. Obviously, we wanted to improve basic and translational knowledge that leads to therapeutic innovation in red cell disease. And one of the better indicators is the number of scientific publications, the number, but also the quality of this publication, and to show that we can translate this basic science to patients in red cell field, but also outside red cell field. Because I think, as I told you this morning, if we study red cells, erythropoiesis or physiology of red cells, what we may find may apply in some lot of different diseases and a lot of different basic science domains outside the red cell field itself. And also try to open what we did find to public and societal problems. So to do so, we did some, and we promote some platform and core facilities around the red cells field. And we try also to foster collaborative project between GRX partners, because I think it's very important to work in synergy between teams and to improve the quality of work and to attract new teams to the GRX consortium. And here it's very important to note that we wanted to attract people working on red cells that were isolated, but also people working outside the red cell field to try if their basic knowledge, if they are good, could apply to the red cell field, and to recruit doctorate and postdoctorate and promote research and university staff with the GRX label, and try to increase the number of grants that we can get, scholarships, fellowships, and so on, and to succeed to organize training courses on red cells at the European level, but also outside Europe, to foster international collaboration. And in addition, we wanted to do some industrial partnership and to deposit patent and create startup and then to be on budget of what we've got. So here it is an organization chart. So there is an executive committee with Caroline Levan-Kim and Laurent Gouya and myself, and we get the help of the managerial teams, which help a lot to try to help us to manage the money and to discuss with the university and so on. And we set up a scientific advisory board from outside, from US and Italy and some other countries, to try to evaluate the politics of the G-Rex and to see if we are going to the good or the wrong direction. And we set up a scientific committee, which include scientists which are able to work on erythropoiesis and iron metabolism, genetics and blood transfusion, malaria, sickle cell disease, on clinic and on basic science, general basic science. And we set up also education committee to improve the education around the red cell fields, and a technology transfer to try to deposit patent and try to move to the clinical application. And interestingly, for the last 3 years, we were able to include from 18 partners at the beginning, now we are 30 partners working on the red cell field around the G-Rex. So here it is a general overall strategy. So as I said before, we wanted to foster the basic science around red cells and iron metabolism, and try to develop this basic science towards the patients, and vice versa, look at the patient cohort and go to the basic science. So to do so, we need some biological studies and diagnostic tool to go from the patient to the basic science, and also a good epidemiology research to be able to set up some cohort of patients, and to transfer this knowledge here for diagnosis and therapeutics, and also to education and training course. So the first things we did within the G-Rex, we put a lot of money to try to improve and to increase the core facilities, and also to set up a clinical platform to be able to take the sample of the patient and to be able to set up some clinical trials and to be connected with the industry partnership to be able to do things very rapidly, because in Europe, and I think same thing in Brazil, it's a very difficult and lot of time consuming to be able to have all of the authorization from the regulatory affair to be able to perform work on the patient samples, and also to start some clinical treatment. And also we realize that genetics is very important, because now we with the tools we have, we can find new genes, and then because we have a good basic science and core facilities, we may understand how the genes may impact some phenotype and some disease related to red cells and iron metabolisms. So here I will summarize what we have now in hand with the core facilities. So this morning we have seen the talk of Caroline on the red blood cell clinics. So now we are able to investigate most of the aspects of the physiology of red cells, including protein expression and migration and deformabilities and so on. So I think it's a very important things to do. And we have also intravital video microscopy platform, which allows us to investigate what the red cells are doing in vivo and in different pathological conditions, but also we can study the interaction between red cell disease and genes involved in red cell disease and other cell types, including inflammatory cells. And we set up also, and I will show you some examples later on, a performance and metabolism platform in mice to be able to study the sport performance of mice depending on the genotype and the red cells of this mice. We develop a metabolic platform in which we are able now to analyze the spectrum of metabolites within the red cells. And we can see here, we can, for example, identify 200 metabolites in these cells. And now looking at what's going on in the metabolome of these red cells, we are able to evaluate, for example, the storage lesion in the red cells, with or without serotonin, as you have seen an example before. Or we use, for example, the metabolome to stratify diabetes patients. And we realize that the patient with diabetes type 2 which onset late during the life and in obesity patients was different from the type 1 diabetes which occurred early on. So based on the metabolome of the red cells, we are able to define if it's a type 2 or type 1 diabetes. And here, for example, we did also in rheumatoid arthritis, and we looked at the red cell metabolomes, and the metabolome changed depending on the activity of the red cells. So by looking at the red cells, we can define and look what's going on in some other place in the body. And we did also perform a proteomic platform during erythropoiesis, and this morning I show you some example by which the red cells go from the undifferentiated multipotent progenitors to the mature red cells which lost their nuclei. And at all stage of differentiation, the profile of gene expression and protein expression is totally changing, and with post-translational modification, for example, now we put all of them in the computer and we have all of the proteomic analysis of these red cells, and now they are also, they will be soon in the website, so everybody working on red cells could use this database to check what is going to some other disease to see if there are some differences or similarity, and we can compare with this normal proteomic evaluation. And now we set up a good genomic platform with the help of the Imagine Institute, which is specialized in genetic disease. So we have all of the facilities to do exome and RNA-seq and whole genome and everything, methylome and so on, in this genomic platform, and with a very good price to do so. And we set up also a gene expression platform, because we know that in the past we knew that erythroid genes are regulated during differentiation because of the transcriptional factors, but we looked at the gene regulation as a linear regulation with some transfer factors which bind to some promoter to activate or don't regulate the expression of some genes. But now we know it's more complicated, because we know there is some enhancer which are able to activate genes which are far away from the binding site of this enhancer. And now by looking at the chromatin in the third dimension, we are able to define what are the mechanism of gene regulation in this third dimension. And we have now, we will set up some partnership with a group of gene expression study outside the red cells, but to apply on the red cell gene regulation. And finally, we have now set up a clinical and epidemiological platforms to be able to study big group of population and to do clinical study, and also to do translational research and on physiopathology and treatment, to try to facilitate all investigators working on basic science to get some samples and eventually to apply their research to patients. So here I will show you some few examples of what we have done in the last 3 years within the context of the GRX, because we put all of these core facilities together and people working together. So first, it is a team of Naomi Taylor and David and Marc Sidbon working in Montpellier in France. And it's very interesting because they were working on immunology, and they didn't know nothing about the red cells. But in fact, they found by chance, I should say, that the glucose receptor, GLUT1, is expressed on red cells. And very interestingly, I should take a few minutes to explain this story, because it was a very interesting story. They showed that, in fact, some species express the GLUT1 on the red cells, and some do not. And they were fortunate to have in their PhD student one girl, her father was the director of the zoo of Montpellier. So they could get the red blood cells to every animals in the zoo. And they defined a tree to understand which species express the GLUT1 on their red cells and which species do not express the red cells on the GLUT1 on the red cells. And in fact, they found that the species which needs vitamin C to survive did express GLUT1. And the one who did not need vitamin C to survive do not express GLUT1. Why? Because in fact, GLUT1 is the receptor of vitamin C, and the red cells are the cells which are storing the vitamin C. For that reason, when you don't eat vitamin C for 3 months, which is the half-life of red cells, you have not any more pool of vitamin C, and you get the scorbut. So it was very interesting discovery. And actually, they look at the bat. And some bat eat some insects, and some need to eat some fruits. And the one eating fruits, they need fruit because they need vitamin C, have GLUT1 on their red cells, and the one who eat insect have no GLUT1 on their red cells. So based on this discovery, they look at the expression of GLUT1 during the differentiation of the red cells, and they found that, in fact, erythroid progenitors do express the GLUT1, and stem cells too, and these stem cells express also a lot of metabolite receptors. And depending on the level of metabolites in the microenvironment, the cells are able to make or to not make red cells, because we, as I said this morning, we do make 10 to the 6 red cells per second. So we need a lot of DNA replication and a lot of nutrients and a lot of nucleotide to be able to do so. So in case of low nucleotide biosynthesis, they showed that the stem cells are going to commit to the myeloid lineages, whereas in case of high level of nucleotide, these cells will commit to the erythroid pathway. And they have shown that the nucleotide biosynthesis depends on the glucose and the glutamine, which is in the environment of these cells. So depending on the microenvironment, you will commit your stem cells to do red cells or myeloid cells. So this one opened a new direction to understand by which mechanisms the cells, the stem cell, can commit to different pathways depending on the microenvironment and the concentration of nutrients in this microenvironment. And interestingly, probably they will end up to synthesize, for example, some glutamate and alpha-ketoglutarate, for example, which now we know this metabolite play a critical role to regulate the epigenetics of the cell. So we have a link now between the metabolite in the microenvironment and the epigenetics, which may regulate the fate of stem cells. I think it was a very interesting discovery, starting from the red cells in the periphery and move back to the stem cells, which now can go back to cancer and a lot of different pathways. So it is a scheme showing that more you have nucleotide, more you make red cells, and less you have, less, more you do myeloid cells. Another interesting thing we discovered, and it was people working not on red cells at all, working on the bone metabolism. And they found that in some disease, FGF23, which is secreted by the bone and in the niche in the bone, is able to supply the cells in erythropoietin. And interestingly, so here also, we could demonstrate that this synthesis in the bone marrow and in the bone may also set up the sensitivity to EPO. More you have FGF23, less you need EPO to make red cells. So here, you have a local regulation, which regulate the level of EPO you do produce in the periphery and sensitize to EPO. So in a lot of the bone disease, some, we know they have anemia, probably because they have a reduction of FGF23 expression. And now we are looking at what is the receptor and the mechanism of action by which these cytokines is able to regulate also erythroid differentiation. So I think I'll show you two examples where working outside erythroid cells may allow to make a good discovery. And I show you this morning also the role of HSP70, why and how HSP70 is important in some erythroid disease and how it might be a good target in the future, but also outside disease in which you have aggregates of the proteins, and thalassemia is the best example, but as I told you this morning, Alzheimer's disease and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis and a lot of disease may involve the same system of HSP70 and localization into the nuclei because of this aggregate of the protein. And also I show you this morning the role of GDF11, a new cytokine we discovered by working on thalassemia, and I show you that it's very important to regulate the FAS ligand expression, and I show you that it may help patients with thalassemia to improve their red blood cell production and hemoglobin level, but this also may apply in a lot of patients with ineffective erythropoiesis. And actually, there is some work on myelodysplastic syndrome in which blocking GDF11 improves also the anemia in this patient. And as I show you this morning, we have a lot of different complications and side effects of ineffective erythropoiesis, which might be corrected by blocking GDF11. And we found, for example, that in leukemia, because in leukemia we know that the proliferation of the cells depends on the reactive oxygen species, and we have shown that this ROS induces the expression of GDF11, which don't regulate Fas-Fas ligand, and we have shown that when we put antibody against GDF11 in leukemic cells in vitro, we induce apoptosis. So here, again, another example by which working on red cells helps to understand maybe the physiopathology of and define new target in leukemia. So here is to show you that in idiopathic polycythemia vera, we know some patients have family polycythemia vera, and most of the cases are genes involved in the regulation of hypoxia and hypoproduction. But we found a family in which they found a JAK2 mutation, but not in the pseudokinase domain as in acquired polycythemia vera, but in the kinase domain. So this one is very interesting because it was the first case in which we show that JAK2 might be mutated at the germinal level to induce polycythemia. And now there is a program based on the genetic study to search new genes which may regulate the erythropoiesis in familial patients with erythrocytosis, with no gene known to be involved in polycythemia. Another example is what we have done in the genomic platform. Because you know, like BLACFAN anemia, which is congenital erythroblastopenia, is in most of the cases due to ribosomal proteins mutations. But in some cases, there is no mutation and no deletion in ribosomal proteins. So we did some exomic studies in patients with BLACFAN anemia, and we found now 8 new genes, which are not ribosomal proteins, which may involve in this disease. And by knowing these new genes, we may discover new regulatory pathway of erythropoiesis and eventually to other cell type. This one, it's an interesting work we've done with it's a societal problem in Peru, because some patients had some people living high in altitude, some get adapted to this high altitude and they make a little bit more hemoglobin to be able to have more oxygenation in the tissue. But some, they go to very high level of hemoglobin, which eventually ends up to develop increased blood viscosity and thrombosis and die of the disease. Some go to 60% or 75% hematocrit level, which is not compatible with life. So in this family, some patients have a low level of hemoglobin, some high level of hemoglobin. So we did a GWAS study to try to define what are the genetic basis of these different regulations in erythroid production. And probably we don't know yet all of the results, but we found a lot of different genes which might be associated, and genes which are totally unexpected, like IL-15, for example, which may regulate also the level of erythropoiesis upon hypoxia. So we have to do a lot of work not to understand what is the physiopathological basis on this genetic finding to explain why you go up or down when you go in altitude. And maybe we will study also some small animals which live very high also, and with this kind of disease. So also we did some work in Africa, and to try to understand the correlation between sickle cell disease and cardiovascular disease. And a good team from the HEGP in Paris, and with the help of the G-Rex, were able to collect more than 4,300 patients and to analyze the cardiovascular parameters depending on their blood parameter in sickle cell. And now they have a lot of different red cells in frozen samples. Now we can study genetics and physiopathology and so on to see the link between sickle cell disease and cardiovascular disease. So we are able to set up a very good collaborative work with a lot of different teams in Africa. In the future, it will be very important to compare this population with the one we have in France and probably also in Brazil. So I think we could do a very interesting study from this work. And this one, it was a very surprising finding that I like to show sometimes. It's we made the hypothesis that if you want to be good in sport, you need to have a lot of hemoglobin and also a lot of iron. Iron to make red blood cells, because we need iron to make red blood cells, but also to have a better generation and of the muscle cells, because you know when you do too much exercise, you want to use a muscle like this, and you lose iron, and you have to catch up more iron to regenerate your muscle. And we make the hypothesis that if you get some genes which allow you to catch up more iron, like hemochromatosis, you may be better. So we look at the mutation of hemochromatosis gene, which is present in 20% of the French population. And as you can see here, when you look at the patient, we are at the national team, for example, in the cross-country ski, 20% of them have this mutation. But when you look at the patient, I mean the subject, we have Olympic champion or world champion and European champion, 80 or 90% of this patient has a mutation. So we could conclude that in this sport, but also in other sports, you know, we have rowing and judo and all of this sport, we have 80% mutation in the HIFA genes. Where the sport where was the best in France, which is the pétanque, the same level. So we demonstrate definitely that high level energetic sport, at a high level, you need to have this this mutation to be good. So if you do high level sport, to have this mutation is good. If you don't do sport, have this mutation is bad because you have iron overload and eventually cardiac and endocrine and problems. So we think that it might have some. First, we have to understand the mechanisms, and in fact, we found that besides the iron, we found that the mice with knockout HIFA, when you look at the performance we did on the platform, they have the same level than the wild-type mice. But when you train these mice, the ones with the mutation, they become much better than the one who do not train. And when you look carefully at these mice, we found that these genes is associated to the better muscle mass and the lower adipocyte mass. So probably HIFA, besides its role to be involved in the regulation of iron metabolism, may play a critical role in the energetic metabolism and to also in the muscle and adipocyte. So based on that, what we are doing now, we're looking at patients with myopathy to see if the HIFA genes influence the phenotype of muscular disease. And maybe we may show that iron may modulate the phenotype of patients with genetic myopathy based on this sport population. So here, another example of, I think Yves talked a little bit yesterday, but I will talk just. For example, we know, and we have shown a lot of work showing that in sickle cell disease and polycythemia vera, there is some phosphorylation of some blood groups, which may induce, like Luteran, increased adhesion to endothelium. And we were looking at one disease, and two diseases actually, is the central retinal vein occlusion, which is the second or the third cause of blindness in Europe. And we don't know what is the cause of the disease. And people are working for years and years to try to understand if there is some thrombophilic genetic event associated with this disease, but none of them were found. And in fact, by chance, we found that this patient has abnormal red cells and abnormal erythropoiesis with a very mild phenotype, but in vitro and in the clinical platform, we were able to show that these cells adhere too much to the endothelial cells, probably because they expose too much the phosphatidylserine. So based on these findings, now we know that we have to target the red cells in order to prevent the relapse of this disease and to prevent blindness. And this was totally unexpected finding. Another disease, like Gaucher disease, and the team of Yves and Caroline found that this patient, in some instances, look at the patient with sickle cell disease, with thrombosis and so on. And in fact, unexpectedly, we found that this patient have abnormal red cells and also abnormal erythropoiesis. So here, we found two diseases in which we didn't expect to see any abnormality in red cells, but in fact, abnormality in red cells are part of the cause of the symptom of this patient. So now, based on that, we can look at other diseases with thrombosis and so on, and try to find new drugs to try to remove this pathological interaction between endothelial cells and red cells. So here another example of biotechnic collaboration that we have done with Metaphora. Metaphora, it's a very interesting story because as I told you before, when you look at the metabolite receptors, most of them are transmembrane receptors in which it's very difficult to have antibodies to recognize by FACS analysis the expression of these receptors. But in fact, these receptors are virus entry for a lot of retroviruses. So this Metaphora, what they have done, they clone the envelope of various virus, and they are able, by staining this envelope of this virus, to see which cells express which receptors depending on the binding of different virus. And for example, we are able, because looks like GLUT1 is one of the receptor for HTLV-1 entry, if you take the envelope of HTLV-1, it binds to cells who do express GLUT1, and you are able to see if the cell express or not GLUT1, whereas it's impossible to do so by antibody because there's no antibody which recognizes some extra domain of the protein. So based on this result, for example, we are able now to diagnose the GLUT1 deficiency, which is associated to neuronal impairment of development. And if you don't treat these kids very early, they will die or eventually they will have a mental retardation. But no, by taking the blood, in 1 minute, we are able to make the diagnosis of GLUT1 deficiency in this patient. So now we are looking at the expression of this metabolite in the red cells to see any correlation with various disease in red cells, but also, for example, in leukemic cells to see if they have a lot of receptor to some metabolites. They may change their epigenetics, for example, and their fate and commitment and so on. So I think it's maybe a very powerful tool in the future, based also on the red cell study. And to finish, malaria, you know, it's a very frequent disease and a lot of which involve a lot of red cells because it is the red cells are the host of the parasite, and we know that red cells interact with the microenvironment to give rise of the disease. And by knowing all of this mechanism, we might be able to stop the development of the parasite, or eventually to stop the interaction between the red cells and the environment. So an example here, we found that some variant of the parasite may adhere to some cells, for example, in the placenta. So by doing this, expressing this protein in the colony, we are able to generate some antibodies to prevent the adhesion of the parasite to the placental cells and to prevent the complication of malaria during pregnancy, which is an example. And here it's also an example of the coming from the Luc Douet team, which work with a lot of partners of the LabX. Now is able to make red cells in vitro to be transfused in the patient from stem cells and from cord blood cells. And actually, he published a few years ago the first example of transfusion from blood generated only in vitro. But now what he tried to do is to take iPS banking, and we have seen that, like Thierry Perard showed us, that some patients are unique patients with only one blood group in the world. And these patients, if they are bleeding, they have no blood available to be transfused. So if we generate some iPS banking and are able to do back to make red cells, we'll be able to have some red cells for this peculiar patient or for patients for low group. And we do a lot of research on this topic to try to improve the yield of red cell production from iPS or different sources of stem cells. And I won't come back to that, but Yves showed you how we could envision serotonin as a new partner in red cell development. Actually, it was very interesting to see like some patients were laughing when they published and they realized that patients taking some antidepressive drugs, like inhibitor of the serotonin recaptures in myelodysplastic disease, they were less transfused. And they said, well, it's because they are not depressed anymore, so they don't need any more blood. But in fact, it might be due to the fact that the inhibition of the serotonin recapture may increase the half-life of the red cells of this patient, and so they were transfused less than the one who do not take serotonin capture inhibitor. So it is an example of what we can do based on this kind of research. And to finish, I will show you that some work involving the iron metabolism. You know the pathway is quite complex, but we know a lot of these proteins are involved in the regulation of the production of hepcidin, which controls the iron entry and release from the macrophages for the erythropoiesis. And you know that recently there is some work showing that erythroferon, which is produced by the red cells, is going to repress the production of hepcidin to allow the cells to uptake more iron, to make more red cells with a fine regulation between the liver and the red cells. But there is still some unknown mechanism, because we know now first that hepcidin is produced by a lot of different tissues, not only the liver, but the brain, the retina, the lungs, and everything. And locally, we know there is some cytokines and some mediators which regulate the iron metabolism locally by regulating the hepcidin production. And we know, like for example, in brain, in Parkinson's disease, there is an accumulation of iron in the brain, which contributes highly to the degradation of the central nervous cell. So if we do understand by which mechanism the iron is locally regulated, we'll be able to cure or to improve the outcome of a lot of disease. Actually, there is some protocol who are starting to treat patients with Parkinson's disease with iron chelator. But also it might be true to different types of organs, and we have a good team in the JREX working on this specific mechanism. And I can say also that probably serotonin plays a critical role in the regulation of iron locally, for example, in the brain. And now we have a good platform with the generation of a new mouse model in which we can knock down hepcidin in different tissues to see what is the role of the systemic regulation by the liver or the local regulation by the production of hepcidin locally. So this one might be also a very good example how to work on iron metabolism and help to cure or improve a lot of different diseases. So now, to come back to what we have done in the JREX, so we have some indicators, and I select some of them. One of them, which is the first one for scientists, I should say, we did publish like 80 publications with the JREX in the last 2 years, which is, I think, a good achievement, and including very good journals like Nature Medicine, Nature Cell Stem Cell, Blood, and so on. So I think because we could work in synergy, we could improve the level of this publication. And also we did some international collaboration, and you know we started to come to Brazil. It was our first outside collaborative work, and we came last year. And now we have some work also with Canada and with Africa, and we did also some training education, and some of you came to Paris last year, and we did a workshop on red cell, and we will do another one next year in Brazil. So we succeed to do, I think, to do some kind of training education. And now we try to set up more partnership with the private sector to try to set up new therapeutic and diagnosis tool. And here to show you just something, I wanted to show you how we organized our budget. So in France, and I think same thing here, it's very difficult to get money for position for the research and so on. So what we emphasize first is try to pay people to have an engineer and to have a technician and PhD and postdoctorant to be able to do the work, because without hands we cannot do the work. And we put some money to start some project. I should say we call more a seed money, between 20 to 40 to 50,000 euros to start a protocol between different teams. And we provide the money only if it is between two or three teams, not if it's only one team. And with these teams, we try to apply to bigger grants. So what I did here is show you what we spent as a money and what we earn by applying to these different grants. Because we work in teams, we have a better project and more succeed to succeed before. For example, we call INR, which is very competitive project in France. None of the projects working on red cells were granted. And last year, I think six were granted based on the work started by the JREX. So I think it's a very good thing we are able to do. And here I show you that with the student and postdocs that we could recruit. And very interestingly, we can promote two full professors because of the JREX. And because now, in France, in 2 years, 3 years, to be part of the G-Rex is a good thing to show to your dean and everything, so it's good. And always I like to say this story. When I start my my fellowship in my hospital, when I see my dean, he told me, you know, if you do work on red cells, you will never be a professor because red cells, no interest, no paper, nothing. So I did something else, obviously, to follow what he said to me. But besides, I still pursue to do red cells. And now, I think I show you that we improve the level of publication, and this publication help you to get, as you can see here, some full professor and free researcher could compete to get a full position in France, which is very difficult, and also working on red cells. So to conclude, and the perspective is to maintain the dynamic of basic research between teams and welcome new teams, and improve and increase the translational research in genetics and therapeutic and transfer of technology, and extend more red cell studies to other fields of science and medicine. I show a lot of examples how we can succeed by doing so. And if we do so, we'll attract a lot of young investigators in the red cell field, and increase international collaborative work, education, and get some more money, obviously, as always. And now to come to practice, because all of the things I show you is more theory, but how we can start this collaborative work between you and us. And I think, and everybody will agree to do that, we are ready to supply the money for a PhD student coming from Brazil to work in the G-Rex lab in France. So we have to define which subject and discuss between teams. But I think we can put in the next call, next year, a PhD money for 3 years to come to France to do some study. And also I may say that in my institute, Imagine Institute, also they put in the program, they pay for PhD students from outside France 4 per year. So I think if somebody from here want to compete to this program, they may have a good chance of success if they are in connection with some people from the G-Rex and from Imagine Institute. What we can do also, and we can also put that for the next call, and we did already, is to try to put some, I should say, some seed money to start a collaborative work between French and the Brazilian teams, like Jacques Elion did, for example. And like that, if we can start some project, and then if it succeeds, we can apply to a bigger grant, like you said, for the French Francophonie, French, Brazilian, and also to see the ambassador of France, because they said he would put some money. But if we come with a previous good collaborative work, it probably will open more easily his pocket. And also we can propose some genetic studies, because the G-Rex put some money, something like 100,000 euros, maybe more, to do genetic studies like NGS, exome, for genetic studies in rare disease, which is, you know, if you have a family with a very strange anemia or very strange phenotype related to red cells or iron metabolisms, if you have a trio, two siblings and one parent, we can go to put this DNA to this platform for free, and you have a very good bioinformatician. They can give you all of the list of the genes which seems mutated and maybe involved in the disease. So if you have some interesting phenotype, you can, if you want, send this DNA and work together to define what's going on. And also we will improve and increase the training education, but you know, we did already a lot of things with your center, and then hopefully in the future we'll pursue this nice collaborative work. And next year in September there will be a 1-week training here, I think, with a collaborative between French and Brazil, and I think it will be a good start for the future. And I think I finish it, and we, as I said always, no red cells, no life, but people said it's negative, so now we have to say red cell is life, which is better. And here it's the picture of our last retreat in Vaucernay, and we have a nice 2 days in the sun, which is not usually in France, but for once it was okay. And we have a nice discussion to start all of this this protocol, more like a football team. Yeah. And if you want, you can access to the website of the G-Rex, and you can see what we've done and what are the events we are doing, and we try to catch up to be in time, but sometimes we have some kind of delay to fool this website. So thank you very much for your attention.